All right, here we go.
Good afternoon, students of DIS and staff of DIS. We're delighted to welcome this afternoon Mr. Sumant Sinha, who's going to join us for the first of our DIS leadership series. Mr. Sinha is a leader in the field of renewable energy in India, an entrepreneur who's doing much to take India into the 21st and 22nd century by changing the energy mix in a way that makes the country's development sustainable and a real source of pride for the country in coming years, I believe. As I said, Mr. Sinha, a great entrepreneur, he's going to share with us his experiences of energy and also about the challenges of entrepreneurship and how we can all strive to succeed in those things which we are trying to undertake. Isha.
Esteemed Mr. Sinha, respected heads, teachers, and students, good afternoon. In today's edition of the DAIS Leadership Series, we are graced by the presence of Mr. Sumant Sinha, the founder, chairman, and managing director of Renew Power, one of India's largest green energy companies. Mr. Sinha founded Renew Power in January 2011, starting with a small wind project in Gujarat and a vision to transform the way energy is produced and consumed in India. Since then, under his leadership, Renew Power has grown exponentially to emerge as one of India's premier renewable power producers, spanning more than 100 sites across the country. It is now amongst the top 50 companies in India by total assets across all sectors, with the fastest rates of growth in assets in India between 2015 and 2020. It is also ranked 7th amongst all Indian unicorns by valuation. Today, Renew generates 1% of India's total electricity annually, and in doing so, helps mitigate 0.5% of India's carbon emissions in a year. Mr. Sinha is a passionate advocate for solutions related to climate change through the intersection of business and public policy. He's a member of the Stewardship Board on Shaping the Future of Energy at the World Economic Forum and serves as the chair of the Climate Group's India Advisory Board. He is also a member of the board of directors of the US-India Strategic Partnership Forum. He chairs the CII's Renewable Energy Council and is on the board of governors of prestigious institutions such as IIM Calcutta, IIT Delhi, and Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs. He is an alumnus of IIT Delhi, IIM Calcutta, and the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia. For his achievements in the areas of entrepreneurship and clean energy, he has won several awards, including Chairman of the Year at the Stevie International Business Awards 2020, the Entrepreneur India's Entrepreneur of the Year Award in 2019, and the coveted Economic Times Entrepreneur of the Year Award in 2018. He has also been conferred Distinguished Alumnus Awards by IIM Calcutta and IIT Delhi, and was listed as the Global Sustainable Hero in 2019 by Green Tech Capital Advisors. So, without further ado, I would like to thank Mr. Sinha for taking the time to be with us today and request him to address all of us with his inspiring words.
Yeah, thank you so much, Isha, for that. And I'd like to thank DAIS for inviting me to give this talk to all of you today. It's always a pleasure and joy to talk to, children, kids, students, who are in fact the future of the country. It sounds a little bit cliched, but that's the reality of the situation. And especially so in the area that I'm involved with, which is climate change, where frankly and unfortunately, our generation has not done as much as it should have. And in some ways is passing on this burden of dealing with the climate change problem to all of you. And so what I'll do today is I'll talk to you a little bit about my journey, how I came to where I've got to, why I got involved with the whole area of climate change and clean energy. And then I'll tell you a little bit about the whole area of climate change and what the implications are for the country, how we can deal with it, and what perhaps all of you need to keep in mind to the extent that you want to get involved with this very important area going forward. So having said that, let me tell you a little bit about my background. Isha, of course, has already done a very good job of giving you a quick sense of it. So after I went to St. Columbus in Delhi, I graduated ago. Then I went to IIT Delhi, did my MBA in IIM Calcutta. And then at some point I went across to Columbia University and did a second master's degree from there. And then I got a job in investment banking in New York, and that's what I started doing. And in my generation, frankly, a lot of people who used to go overseas, to the US, would get jobs there and essentially basically just settle down. And so that's what I did too. I was in New York City. It was terrific to be there as a young person, working hard, but also enjoying life. And so I did that for many years. For 3 years in the middle, I was in London as well. And then somewhere around, after having done investment banking for about 10 or 12 years, I started questioning what I was doing and why I was living outside of India. And my general feeling was at that point in time that that India would at some point also take off, just like China was taking off at that point in time. And I'm talking here about a time before probably a lot of you were born, which is really around the turn of the millennium, so around the year 2000, 2002. China was already doing very well. And I had this real strong belief that India would also join the countries that were growing rapidly and would grow rapidly as well at some point in time. And I didn't want to miss the bus on it. And therefore, I wanted to come back to India. But the second thing also was that I just missed being in India. I just liked the country. I enjoyed growing up here. And I missed the sights and the sounds and the smells of the country. And so, I did really want to come back. And I just felt that I had lived outside of India for many years. I had got whatever experiences and whatever inputs and whatever learnings and whatever exposure I wanted. And I really felt the urge and the desire to come back to the country. And so that was somewhere at the back of my mind. And, I used to come to India quite frequently at that time. And during one of those trips, I met Mr. Kumar Mangalam Birla, who heads the Aditya Birla Group. And he made me an offer to basically come in and join his group as the head of finance. And that was a pretty interesting opportunity to have got. I was still relatively young at that time. And so to come into a very large group like that was a very good way to come back to India. And so I thought about it very seriously. But, the whole issue of basically coming from a different country, and my wife was working in the US and my daughter was going to a Montessori there, and we had this nice suburban life in New York. So just giving up on that and coming back to India seemed like a big stretch. So I actually said no in the beginning. But then life is, I have discovered, all about fate. Sometimes you don't plan for things to happen, but they just happen. And as it turns out, many months later, I had come back to India for a holiday, and I ran into Mr. Birla in Goa. And he said, Sumant, would you be interested again to come back and think about this position? And so I said, I've thought about it, and I perhaps would like to come back. And so that's why I made the big transition of leaving the US and coming back to India. And then I started working with him in the Birla Group in Mumbai. So I was actually there in Mumbai for about 8-9 years, working as a corporate person in Mumbai. And I learned a lot while I was there. Working in the Birla Group was a very, very interesting experience. I was the head of finance, so I learned about how companies operate, how they invest money, how investors think about value creation issues. So quite a lot of things that I learned during my time there. And it was very interesting. But, as I said earlier, very often life moves in ways that you sometimes cannot fathom. And you just have to keep putting yourself in the best possible positions. And sometimes opportunity just knocks. And that is in some ways what happened to me about 10 years ago, 12 years ago. I got a call from a company that was operating in the climate change space. And they just said, look, would you like to come and work for us? And frankly, I hadn't really thought deeply about the whole area of climate change until that point in time. I knew it was something that was somewhere in the background. But frankly, I didn't really think that India was responsible for a lot of carbon emissions. And therefore, I didn't feel that India was responsible for doing something about it as well. So I didn't really know much about the topic. But this call from this company that wanted to hire me forced me to think about it, and I did think about it. And my general feeling was that, you know, if you eventually want to go and do something on your own, if you want to become an entrepreneur, then you have to select an area which is a new area. You know, it's very hard to take a brand, you take a very existing old traditional area and try to come up with some new ideas in that area. And so therefore I said, you know, climate change seems like it's a new area, it's an upcoming area, it's an important thing. It has a sense of purpose behind it because you're doing something which is good for the world as a whole and good for humanity. And so I said, why not? And so I left my job and I joined this company. And I was in that company for a couple of years, but my desire to set up something on my own had really come into my head at that point in time. And as I said, this was a new area. Government policies were changing quite rapidly. And so I thought, you know, this is a good time for me to now jump off and really try to do something on my own. And that's what I did. But, you know, what happens is that you make certain plans, you think about the way the future might turn up. You try to, you know, be as prepared for it as possible. But you still have to go through the motions. You still have to do a lot of very difficult things before you can be successful. So one of the things that I needed to do when I started this company, my own company called Renew Power, was, and just to give you a very quick sense of what we do in our company, is that we are a company that does projects in India. We set up solar farms and wind farms. We set up the wind turbines, we set up the solar panels, and we own these solar panels and these wind farms. And whatever power is generated by either the sun shining on the solar, the wind going through the turbines, that power that is generated, we then sell it to the companies that distribute power to end customers, to households, to factories, to industrial customers, to hospitals, to cinema halls, and so on. And so we actually make the power. We generate the power ourselves. And because it's coming from sources which are there all the time, the wind blows all the time, the sun shines all the time, therefore these are called renewable sources. And these renewable sources don't cost anything because the wind is blowing. Anybody who can harness it is able to generate power from it. And similarly from the sun. Of course, the equipment costs something, but once the equipment is set up, then the cost of actually generating the power is not very high. And so that's the work that my company does. We set up these large wind farms spread over hundreds of acres, as far as the eye can see. And we set up these giant wind turbines. These wind turbines are higher than the Qutub Minar, which is actually only 73 meters high. Our wind turbines can be as high as 120, 130, 140 meters. And each blade that we have, typically a wind turbine has three blades, each blade can be as long as 60 to 70 meters by itself. So it's a fairly mammoth task to erect these big, huge, long towers and get these blades shipped to wherever these towers are being erected, and then hoist these blades all the way up 130 meters, these 60, 70 meter long blades, and then suspend them from the top of the tower. And then, you know, fix all the electrical plumbing and wiring so that when the blades start rotating, power is generated and that is then fed into the grid, which then gets to your homes or your school, for example. So that's the role that that our company does. And so 10 years ago, I saw that this was going to be a big opportunity because we needed to generate energy from cleaner sources. And we did not require energy from really the dirtier or the polluting sources because it was emitting carbon into the atmosphere. And that was really leading to all these problems around carbon emissions, temperature changes, and so on. And so really that was how I started my company. But, you know, ours is a very capital intensive business because you have to buy all this equipment and install it. And so I had to, having, you know, not really a lot of money of my own, I had to go and raise this money from other people. And who are the people I raised this money from? Are basically companies like private equity companies that you must have heard about or read about in the newspapers. These are people who have the capital and they are looking for good entrepreneurs or they're looking for good investment opportunities. And so I felt that here I am, I have a good background of having been in the sector, of having worked in the financial world for many years, and I have a good idea. All I need is the capital, and there are all these people out there who are willing to give you the capital. So I just need to put the two together. And if I can do that, then hey presto, I have a business and I can get it off and running and then keep growing it after that. Easier said than done, unfortunately, right? And so what happened is that I went knocking on many doors of these private equity guys and I said, guys, here's my idea. It's a terrific idea. Climate change is going to be a big issue. This business is going to grow for many, many years. So would you guys be interested in investing in my company? And, you know, for one reason or the other, you know, they said, not really, this, that, and the other. And it was quite a difficult process to go and raise capital. And fortunately, you know, I knocked frankly on as many doors as I could find. And because I lived in Mumbai, I knew most of the private equity folks. So I reached out to all my friends. I knocked on many doors. And one of those private equity guys, even though many of them were not interested, one of them was. And that was a company called Goldman Sachs, which is this very large US investment bank, which also has a private equity business. So they said, hey, Sumant, come on in. You know, we've actually just started our business in India. We would like to invest in your sector and tell us what your idea is. And so we had a lot of conversations and within a very short period of time, they had made the decision to invest in my company. And you know, the learning I had from that experience was that, you know, I would never have found them if I hadn't gone knocking on as many doors as I could find. And it's very disheartening sometimes when you go and talk to somebody and they say, look, we're not interested. And you talk to the second person and they say, we're not interested. And you talk to your 13th or 14th or 15th person and the answer remains the same. But the reality is I just needed that one person to say yes. And so it didn't matter to me how many doors I knocked on because I did not know which door would be the one that would actually give me the opportunity. And so my learning was that you have to knock on as many doors as you can find. You have to pound the pavement and you should never have the attitude of giving up. You should always just keep going and persevering because, as I said, you never know when the tide is going to turn in your favor and you don't know which door you knock and the opportunity is waiting behind that door. You know, there is a saying which says opportunity knocks. My experience has been that actually you have to do the knocking. You have to go and knock on every door yourself. And then, you know, opportunity will be sitting waiting for you behind one of those doors. So I think that is one learning that I had, which is that you have to constantly be at it. You have to constantly persevere and you should never give up. So I think that was a very important lesson that I learned from that whole experience. But the good news was that Goldman stepped up and they agreed to fund my business by investing $200 million, which at that time was about 1,000 crores, which was a lot of money about 10 years ago. Still is today, but certainly 10 years ago, it had significant value. And that really got me started. And I hired a team of people after that, and we started doing projects of putting up wind farms and solar farms on the ground. Now, keep in mind that that was not really my background. I had not really gone into the back of beyond in India and gone to places which are very small towns and very small villages and found cheap land and executed projects there and so on, because I had been a banker when I was in the US and you know, I had been when I was in Mumbai. So this was also a new experience for me and I had to really on the fly learn and try to make sure that it worked out. And so the second learning that I had was that you have to be very flexible in your own approach to doing things. You have to have a very broad mindedness about the kinds of things that you have to do. And so I went and I did a lot of very operating things. I really got my hands dirty. I really had to roll my sleeves up and go to all these places and actually execute projects there myself on the ground because I had a very small team in the beginning. And I had to make sure that nothing went wrong because these are the first projects that our company was doing. And so we had to make sure that they would be successful. And so it is very important to make sure that I got involved in all the execution issues myself which is what I did. But slowly, slowly, our company grew and we set up more capacity. And as we did, we hired more people and we raised more capital from other investors as well. And then I found that slowly our company was becoming bigger. And about 5 years ago, we crossed that magic threshold number of $1 billion of market value. And you know, that made us a unicorn, which was a pleasant thing. But it was not something I was aiming for, but it happened. Now, nevertheless, we carried on going after that. And then about a year and a half, 2 years ago, we finally became the biggest company in India by our installed wind farms and solar farms. And it's been a truly rewarding journey in that sense, that we have grown so rapidly and got to the point that we've got to. And I've also learned a lot on this journey. And so therefore, one of my other learnings has been that you have to have a real mindset to keep learning all the time, learning from your employees, learning from the market, learning from your competitors, and really, as I said earlier, being very flexible in your approach on how you manage things and how you grow things. And you have to learn to grow with your own company. And so I think that was a very, very important lesson that I learned. The other lesson I learned, which is very important, is that it's very important to have a very transparent company where everybody that is working for you or that is investing in you can see what you're doing or what you're not doing. So I think that is very important. And a very strong underlying principle is ethics. You need to have a very strong sense of integrity. You need to have a very strong sense of doing the right thing at all points in time. And very importantly, you know, as an entrepreneur, you have so many things that come and hit you at the same time. You need to have the ability of staying calm under pressure, because you will be put under a lot of pressure if you ever try to or decide to become an entrepreneur. A lot of things that can go wrong will go wrong. Things that you cannot anticipate will come and hit you and impact you. And through all of that, you just have to make sure that you keep going. You don't lose your cool, don't get stressed, because the people around you that report to you, that work with you, they will be able to sense that stress. Plus your family will also be able to sense that stress. So it's very important to stay very calm and deal with all the problems as they arise. Now, let me tell you a little bit also about the climate change issue, because that really is a very, very important issue in the whole world. That you all as young people should be really aware of. And let me tell you a little bit about that. You know, I'm sure all of you have heard about or read about climate change and about carbon emissions and how the environment is changing around us and you know, what are the ill effects of global warming and so on. So let me take a little bit of a few minutes to just spell out what my understanding is of this whole issue and what we as a country and what we collectively globally can do about it and should be doing about it. So the first point is that, you know, in terms of carbon in the atmosphere, that is really what creates this thing called the greenhouse effect. Because you have more carbon, it essentially traps the sun's rays that come into the earth and does not let them reflect back into space. And because of that, the earth heats up more than it should, right? And that is really what causes the whole issue of climate change. Now, if you look at some of the data, you'll find that the world has been heating up considerably. And in fact, let me just project a slide to show you some data that might be interesting for all of you. So I am just going, and I hope you can see this. Okay, I'm just going to go ahead, yes, assuming that you all can see this. Okay, yes. Great. Okay, so, you know, we've had two energy transitions before this in our history as a human race. The first energy transition that happened was when we moved from biomass, which is really burning wood, to burning coal. And that happened literally at the end of the 19th century, at a time when The steam engine really was created and invented in England, and from that point on, we had this growth in coal that you can see here. And then around the mid 1900s, we had the second energy transition, which was basically a move into oil and gas. And from that point on till now, our entire energy system as a human race has been predicated primarily on these three fuels, which is coal, oil, and gas. But what is happening is that in the last 10 years or so, we have a new energy transition, a third energy transition that has started. And that is really the start of renewable energy, the wind and the solar technologies that are now coming up. And I'll talk about that in a quick sec. Now, here is some very interesting data. Globally right now, the world emits about 9 odd gigatons of carbon into the atmosphere every year. It was about 3 tons about 50 years ago. It's now about 9 tons, so it's grown about 3 times. And which are the countries that emit the most carbon? No surprise, China is number one with almost 30%. The US is number two, but India is number three. And so India is actually a big contributor to the carbon emissions that are going on right now. So we do about 7% of the total carbon. But the difference between us and some of the other countries is that India is going to grow rapidly, right? As we industrialize, as our economic growth happens, as GDP growth happens, this 7.3% number, which translates to roughly about, let's say, 0.65 gigatons every year, that number can double or triple as we go forward. So that's really the worrying thing. And the question is, what can India do about it? Now, let's look at how much carbon there is in the atmosphere. And you'll find that what all the experts say is that the total amount of carbon that we can have in the atmosphere should not exceed 700 gigatons. Anything more than that will lead to a temperature increase of more than 2 degrees centigrade once that happens. And so therefore, this is kind of the magic number. Now, the unfortunate thing is that of that magic number of 700, we've already emitted from the beginning of our history as a world about 600 gigatons. So we really only have about 100 gigatons left, right? And we're going at about 9 to 10 gigatons every year. And so therefore, the reality is, and this is where the urgency really comes from, that within 10 to 15 years, we would have exhausted this 100 gigatons remaining carbon budget. And so we really don't have time. And which is why some people call the climate change crisis the climate emergency, because it's reached that point where we have very little time to act. We really, really need to act very fast. And this is really why. This shows you the rise in global temperatures all the way from the 1880s, which is when coal started coming into our mix. And then you see 1950s or so, which is where this chart has been baselined, is when oil came in and started really increasing. And you can see the temperature increase since then has already happened by 1 degree centigrade in the last 50 years, right? So we already have had 1 degree. Now the question is, how much more is going to happen in the next few years' time? And every year that we have now, we find in modern history, ends up being the hottest year on record. So 2016 was the hottest year. 2019 globally was the second hottest year. And I was just reading somewhere that 2020 is on track to become the hottest year ever. And this is leading to disrupted weather patterns, bushfires, cyclones. And then, of course, we have our own localized problem in northern India, which is the severe air pollution. And that is causing a lot of the most polluted cities in the world to be in India, in northern India, in fact. And unfortunately, I live in Gurugram, which in this list is the most polluted city, unfortunately, in the world. And these days is really when it's most polluted. You know, I used to go out for a jog every morning, and because the AQI has now crossed 300, I have stopped doing that because I don't want it to lead to more harm than benefit. So this is a real problem that is emerging. Now, very quickly, energy accounts for 73% of total emissions globally. Now, what is energy? Energy is basically electricity, transportation, industry, and various other things like buildings and so on. Now, there are two energy transitions that are happening right now. One is that a lot of these other sectors, through electric mobility, electric vehicles and so on, more things are moving into electricity. And the second thing that is happening is that this electricity generation is becoming cleaner because we have more renewables that is coming into the system. So as a result of that, you have more energy moving to electricity over time and the electricity itself becoming cleaner. And this really gives us hope because, as I said earlier, energy accounts for 73% of all carbon emissions. And so therefore, if we can set the energy problem right, then that will deal with a lot of the carbon problem that we have. And so the question is, in all of this stuff, where is the good news, you might very well ask? And the good news really is in these two charts. This is the cost of solar energy generation, which has come down dramatically. And this is the cost of wind generation, which has also come down dramatically. And both wind and solar now are the cheapest form of new electricity consumption. And because of that, it is inevitable that you'll have more and more wind and solar coming up in the next several decades going forward. And that is why not only will extra demand that is required for electricity generation come from wind energy and solar energy, but also all the existing capacities that we have, which are powered by fossil fuels, over time, those will also move to wind and to solar, which are clean sources. And therefore, that whole number of 73%, a large part of that will then begin to come down. And that is really the big hope for humanity right now, that technology is evolving at a very rapid pace that is going to make this transition happen really, really, I think, at an expedited pace. And my company, Renew Power, is doing exactly this, which is that we set up wind farms and solar farms. And as we said earlier, our company now generates 1% of India's total electricity production, and by our calculation, helps mitigate almost 0.5% of the carbon that India as a country might have emitted, but will now not emit because 1% of our electricity has now moved to clean sources. Now, I'll give you a very quick other factor, which is that if I look at the growth of India's electricity sector over the next 10 to 12 years, we have to double the total amount of electricity that we consume because of our economic growth, which means that we'll have to set up 350,000 megawatts more of renewable energy capacity just to meet that demand. And that is equal to the entire capacity of India's power sector that we have installed from all sources from the dawn of our history. And that is something that we have to now redo only through clean energy sources in the next 10 years. And this will require an investment of almost $500 billion in the next 10 years. So this is actually a massive, massive opportunity. There is a lot of technology evolution that is happening. There are lots of very interesting developments that are happening. And therefore, I'm very, very convinced that this change is going to happen. It is going to be path-breaking, and it is going to be really, really something that transforms, hopefully, Indian cities, the pollution in Indian cities, and really puts India on a path where we can take global leadership and tell the rest of the world, guys, we are not the ones that have polluted or put the carbon into the atmosphere, but we are the ones that have found the solution of having dealt with this problem. And so therefore, you have to essentially follow down the same path that we are going down and make sure. Am I still sharing my screen? How do I stop? Yeah, here, let me do that. Okay. So this is an incredible opportunity for India as a country to take the lead in this really new and emerging sector and really, you know, take moral leadership in the world around solving the climate change problem, which is one of the most intractable problems, one of the most difficult problems that we have to solve as a world. Now, the interesting thing is that while we are all, you know, beset with COVID and so on, and we're working furiously on trying to find a solution for COVID, the reality is, and we'll hopefully find a vaccine in the next few months' time, the reality is that for climate change, there is no vaccine. There is no vaccine for climate change. It is something that you really have to solve slowly, slowly by yourselves, by all the countries working together. And if I'm a country that wants to prevent COVID infection to come into my country, I can seal my borders. I can prevent people from coming in or going out. But I cannot do that with climate change. In climate change, we are all literally in the same boat. All the countries of the world are in the same boat. And so therefore, we have to make sure that the boat as a whole is protected and improved. And so therefore, as I said earlier, all the countries of the world have to recognize this problem and have to work on it together. And India has this incredible opportunity, as I said earlier, of taking the lead, both morally and in technology and in manufacturing, and showing the world how this can be done. And this is a very unique opportunity because there aren't that many sectors in which India can actually take the lead. And I think the government is doing a terrific job on making sure that this is one sector where we don't come late to the party, and therefore companies like mine and others are really working hard to make sure that India can demonstrate real leadership in this sector going forward. So for all of you who are looking at a career in something different, I think this is a very interesting area. For the next 30, 40 years for sure, this is going to be a sector that is going to grow rapidly and is going to offer really, really interesting opportunities in technology, grid management, batteries, lots of different areas. So I would really encourage all of you to think about it and look at it seriously. So let me stop there and let me give all of you a chance to ask any questions that you would like. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for that insightful talk, Mr. Sinha. Climate change is very important in today's day and age. And this is something that is a very important issue, and I'm glad that you were able to share with the students. We will now be moving on to the question and answer session. So if anyone has any questions that you'd like to ask Mr. Sinha, you can just raise your hands. And if after I call on you, you can just unmute and switch on your camera and ask the questions. Okay, we can start with Shashra.
Yeah, I'll just one second. Can you see me?
Yeah, I can. Oh,
yeah. So, sir, considering you've had considerable experience in this area, what are your views on the Paris Accord and other such international agreements which have been on climate change, which have been executed? So, do you think we should be doing more, or are we on the right track?
Yeah, so you know, Shashwat, the Paris Climate Accord was a pretty path-breaking accord because before that, all the countries of the world had been fighting on climate change. See, the issue is the following, that it is the developed countries that have emitted most of the carbon that is sitting in the atmosphere. Okay, but it is countries like India which are going to do more of the carbon emissions in the future. But we haven't done the carbon emissions that are already there. So the question is, that why should a country like India take a huge burden of solving the problem that was not created by us? Okay, and so therefore there is this whole issue of equity. Whose fault was it and who should solve the problem? The second thing is that India is not as wealthy a country as are some of the other countries in the western part of the world, right? So should we be allowed to develop, or should they be supporting us in that development path? Third question is, every country in the world so far has grown in a way where they've used a lot of fossil fuels. Now, India has to grow in a way where we can't use a lot of fossil fuels because of the problems that already exist. So we have to grow in a different way. So all the countries have different kinds of burdens and responsibilities. And finding, there are 193 countries in the world. And so finding solutions where every country takes on its own obligations, recognizes them and finds its best solutions, such that all the world coming together is able to not exceed the 2 degrees centigrade temperature change, is a very hard exercise. But in the Paris Climate Accord, somehow the world got together and came up with an agreement, which was a voluntary agreement, that every country said, look, I volunteer to do this because I recognize it's a problem. Okay. Now, if you added up all the contributions that all the countries made, it was still putting us on a path to 3.5 degrees centigrade temperature change, which is still not enough, but at least it was something, right? So I would say that we need much more of these kinds of agreements to happen, because even though it came together, it still was not sufficient. So we need much more to happen. But unfortunately, since the Paris Climate Agreement, we've actually regressed as a globe. The reason we've regressed is that some of the largest countries in the world have pulled out of the Paris Climate Accord, right? Because their governments have changed, and therefore they've said, oh, we don't agree with whatever the previous government had done, so we are pulling out of it. So in actual fact, in the last 4 years, we have, on a multilateral basis, we've actually taken a step back. So we need to do more, but we're doing less. Now, the only hope that we have is that every country individually, whichever country wants to, individually recognizes its own responsibilities and does what it can. And I must tell you, Shashwat, you should be proud in this respect of being an Indian, because India is really taking a lot of moral leadership in this area. Okay, and by pushing very hard on renewable energy, by pushing forward on climate, on forest cover and so on, we are really taking the lead. And we are really pointing the finger at other countries of the world and saying, guys, even though we are not the richest country in the world, we are doing our best. You have to do more as well. And that's a role that India has taken, which I think is very, very positive. Now, we are being helped in that because the cost of the technology has improved so much that the cost of doing good has also become commercially attractive. And therefore, there is now a coming together of commercial attractiveness and what is morally and otherwise the right thing to do. And so that is what is happening. And ultimately, it is that issue that is going to solve this problem most, rather than, unfortunately, all the countries coming together and doing what is required to be done. Thank I hope you. That answers your question.
Thank you.
Anirudh, do you want to go next?
Yes, sir. So my question was in regards to the group of islands known as the small island developing states, and like considering their specific vulnerabilities due to their overdependency on fossil fuels such as oil, and they have virtually no renewable resources developed on the islands themselves. What do you think is the first step for them? Like, how do they proceed in terms of developing their energy sectors renewably or sustainably?
Yeah, so look, that's obviously a good question. For these guys, obviously, they don't have coal either. So a lot of them just import diesel or oil and just burn that in diesel gensets and use that to generate power. But I think now what's happening is that with solar costs having come down to the extent that they have, and solar panel efficiency also improving, you can actually set up solar panels within a part of the island, which are not all fully inhabited, and actually use that to power the island's grid. Now, that is not going to be sufficient because solar panels only work when the sun is shining, and they don't work at nighttime or in the evenings. So you need to also install batteries, and which you can store the solar energy and then use the batteries to discharge in the evening to provide the power. For example, the Indian government is doing that in the Andaman Islands. They've actually got a tender out for 15 megawatts of installation, which should be sufficient to power at least the main island of Andaman. And so those kinds of things really need to happen more and more of. And as I said, technology is evolving, those solutions are becoming more competitive. And so it's much better to have those solutions than to have diesel going to all these islands. You have diesel spilling happening, destroying, you know, coral reefs and marine habitation and so on, and also spewing the smoke into the atmosphere. So I think all of that has to be discouraged. And frankly, I'll tell you one thing, that it's the small island nations that are most worried about climate change, for obvious reasons, right? Because obviously sea levels will go up and they'll all vanish. So they are really, really taking the lead and trying to put as much pressure as they can from their side to really get the larger countries to move towards climate change mitigation steps as well. So I think from their side, they are doing definitely whatever they can. And really, solar plus storage is the solution that probably will work best for them going forward.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Okay, Sanya.
Hi, so basically my question was something that's really imperative is India fully beginning to depend on sustainable energy, which is like eventually the goal for all countries. My question to you is, how would you see India doing that as non-renewable sources are like its current like main factor in fuel, and how long do you think it would take?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And obviously, that's what I work on all the time. And we have lots of discussions with the government also on these issues. So look, if you look at, and I, you know, I presented a slide, then I'll just give you some very quick numbers. Today, India as a whole consumes 1.4 trillion units of power. Okay, just think of 1.4 trillion units. Over the next 12 years, that is going to double. We'll need another 1.4 trillion units of power. Okay, so that by itself is, by the way, quite a big deal that we're going to double within a short period of time. Now, the question is, where will this new 1.4 trillion units of power come from? It is going to come from renewable energy because it's now become so cheap. So today, renewable energy is cheaper than coal-based power or gas-based power or nuclear power or hydro or anything else for that matter. So therefore, it is natural that people are going to buy more and more renewable energy going forward. So as you look over the next 10 to 12 years, the whole power sector is going to flip. And instead of having coal as a predominant, as a market share or predominant factor, we'll have renewable energy as a predominant factor. So, but the fact is that we have such a huge amount of legacy already installed of coal that even 12 years later, coal will be 50% of our power, renewable energy will be 35%. So even after that, for the next 10 years after that also, you have to have more and more renewable energy coming up. And so we'll have almost all new energy becoming renewable energy. And over time, coal will just become smaller and smaller and smaller. And at some point, even that will get phased out and replaced. And so all of this will take at least 30 to 40 years, if you ask me. And so for the next 30 to 40 years, you will have renewable energy basically becoming the first, the predominant source, and eventually the only source of new power. And eventually it will go back and replace all the existing legacy sources of power. And so eventually the grid, 30, 40 years later, by 2050 or 2060, our entire power generation will be solar and wind. And eventually we'll all start having solar on our rooftops as well. And we'll be generating our own solar power and feeding that into the grid whenever we have surplus power. So we'll be making money out of that as consumers as well. So the whole power sector is going to flip totally as a result of that.
Thank you. Athar?
Oh, I have two questions. Is that fine?
Sure. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so my first question is, speaking from someone, from the perspective of someone who is currently in the field of renewable energy, what do you see as the greatest challenge to the implementation of renewable energy in the world and specifically in India?
Okay, you want to give me a second question as well? So then I'll answer both.
Oh, sure. So the second question is also, is it feasible for one to make significant contributions to prevent climate change at an individual level? And like, if yes, how?
Yeah. Okay, so listen, on the first question of what are the limiting factors, as you can imagine, this is India, so there are many limiting factors, right? Doing business in India is never an easy proposition, just given all the systems and issues that we have. So look, first of all, you know, you have to acquire huge amounts of land. You know, 1 megawatt of solar power requires about 5 acres of land. And the same for 1 megawatt of wind requires about 4 or 5 acres of land, right? So the first thing is you go to far away back of beyond areas, as far away from habitation as possible, because there the land is cheapest and you don't have any people around that you're displacing or anything of that sort. So you go to really rural areas, first of all. By the way, there's no infrastructure there. So you have to build your own roads. And, you know, and can you imagine, I was talking about these 60, 70 meter blades, taking them over hills and valleys and, you know, dales and rivers where there's no infrastructure and these huge turning radiuses for all these things. It's quite a difficult exercise. So that's one issue, okay, which is the sheer aspect of physically constructing all of these projects on the ground. You know, it's climate change, it's renewable energy, it sounds good, but at the end of the day, it's a hardcore infrastructure execution business as well. Okay, so we as a company, by the way, have acquired more than 25,000 acres of land all across India to put up all of our wind farms and solar farms right now. Okay, and over the next 10 years, we are looking at a 3x or 4x growth of what we are right now. So we'll have to acquire another 75,000 acres of land. That's going to be a mammoth exercise. So that's one factor. And then, you know, there are issues around raising capital, which I talked about. We need $500 trillion of capital. So that's going to be a big exercise that, you know, we'll have to undertake, not just we, but the whole industry. And third is government policy, because technology is evolving so fast that the solutions, the best solutions are changing also very fast. And whatever investments you make, get locked in for 25 years. So if you lock in the wrong technology, you're locked in for 25 years if you deploy the wrong technology. Because maybe 2 years later, there's a better technology, right? So maybe I should just hold off doing something for 2 years and then deploy it later. So therefore, government policy also becomes very important. So I would say those are the biggest issues that I see in execution. And then your second question was, what can all of us do individually? I think that's obviously very important as well, because while we are doing whatever we're doing at a macro level, all of us individually is really where the action is at. We all have to take individual responsibility, which means things, simple things like switching off lights, okay, whenever you don't require them, not having wasteful, extravagant lifestyles, using a lot of personal jets for travel, which a lot of people might be doing. Minimizing it to the extent possible. Sometimes it can't be avoided, of course. Things like cleaning up aviation, cleaning up the maritime industry, very critical. I would say the other thing that we have to do very much is on the pollution side, because that's as difficult. So plastic, minimizing plastic, right? Trying to move to electric vehicles from petrol cars and so on, moving in that direction. And whenever you buy anything, just making sure that it is produced with as small a sort of a carbon footprint as possible. Just becoming more alive and sensitive to these things. As all of you, grow, you'll all go into companies and start working in various places. Some of you will have your own companies, some of you will start your own companies, some of you will join companies and make them bigger. So in whatever you do, think about this. Think about how to make your organization more sustainable. That is very, very important, because ultimately keep in mind that the corporate sector is also a big user of carbon. And so companies have to also reduce their carbon footprint dramatically. And companies ultimately are what? Companies are individuals. It's people who make decisions in companies, right? So therefore that's one big thing that can be done as well. So I think those are the kinds of things that all of us have to do individually in our lives.
Great, thank you so much. Could I have a quick follow-up question?
Depends on Isha.
Oh, yeah.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, so I was reading something the other day about how carbon footprint was actually a term coined by one of the major oil companies like in the 1900s as a way to shift the blame from the carbon footprint from the big companies to individuals. So can we actually make that much of a difference individually, or is it just something that we can do to feel better about ourselves?
No, you can do something individually. It's not like that you can't. As I said, first of all, in your individual life, you should try to minimize your carbon footprint as far as possible. But then more importantly, as I said, all of you will be in decision-making roles in organizations, could be in government, could be in the private sector, could be wherever it is. There also, as an individual, you only have to take the decision to decide what your corporate or your organization does. It's not that a corporate is some faceless entity. A corporate is run by somebody. It's an individual. That person can make an individual choice that I want my company to be a clean company. I want my company to contribute to sustainability. I want my company to reduce its own carbon footprint, right? And then the company will act on that basis. So individuals ultimately are the ones that have to make a difference. Similarly, for all I know, Atharva, you might go and join politics in the US, right? And you may go and influence US policy and make, the US, having a smaller carbon footprint by becoming the Secretary of Energy for all I know. So you'll be an individual. So in your individual capacity, in that role that you're doing, you can surely have a big influence.
Okay, sure. Makes sense. Thank you so much.
Okay, Dhruv, do you want to go next?
Yeah, thank you. So stemming from your previous answer and considering the opportunities in remote areas and deserts, things like that, how do you mobilize a team to work towards these goals, which are not easy goals to achieve from a leadership role? And since you mentioned it's a collective effort, how do you get such a big task done efficiently?
You mean as in executing projects in back of beyond areas?
Yeah, as like how you mobilize a team to work and achieve such a big thing.
So, you know, you can find people. It's not such a big problem. Ultimately, it's not that we are the only ones doing infrastructure projects in remote areas. People who are building dams or building even roads or highways in those areas, you know, they're all also going and operating in those kinds of places. So, and you know, what you have to do is, of course, you have to provide a good environment for people to stay in, right? You have to give them certain allowances for being in those areas away from their families. And then you have to rotate them in and out. You can't keep them, you know, in remote areas. So you have to rotate them into urban centers, into rural centers, and so on. And I think by doing those kinds of things, and by recognizing their effort, which is very important, you know, you can motivate people to go and stay in those areas for certain periods of time and do, you know, the difficult things that have to be done in these areas. So it's not that hard. It's definitely possible.
Thank you.
Okay, Shravani.
Yeah, so my question is like a follow-up from the point of pollution that you brought up. So I was reading the other day that the Fukushima power plant has a lot of nuclear waste stored in their tanks, which is essentially diluted carbon-14, and that's harming like the health of citizens that live in that area. So the solution to that is to dump it in the ocean, where it will inevitably affect marine life. So I kind of have two questions about that. So how ethical is it to prioritize human health over the marine life? And is there a better alternative to this?
So look, I am not an expert on disposal of nuclear waste, so I can't give you an exact answer. But surely releasing it into the ocean can't be a good answer, because obviously you'll, you know, it can spread anywhere. And radioactivity, as you know, stays in the environment for whatever is a half-life, which can be, 100 years or thereabouts. And so, clearly releasing nuclear waste, which can be toxic, into oceans is not at all a good idea. I mean, I would think that that is something that should not be done at all. And in fact, this is one of the problems with things like nuclear energy, which is that not only is it, it requires very large sized installations, which if they happen next to you, then you obviously would be very scared about something going wrong. So that's one danger. Then the second thing is, where do you dispose of nuclear waste? What if there's an accident like it happened in Fukushima, or with your wherever you're storing the waste, if something happens, an earthquake happens, God forbid, and some of the stuff leaks out, then it can really, really be damaging. And so to my mind, technologies like nuclear and all have really, really outlived their usefulness, and we just have to move away from it. But the reality is we still have legacy plants that will keep running for a long period of time, and disposal of that waste is going to be a constant problem for people for a long period of time to come. But it's unfortunately mistakes that we as a human race have made in the past, and now we have to live with the consequences of it. But clearly putting it into the oceans and just letting it go loose definitely is not a good solution.
Thank you. Yash?
Hi. Considering how important do you think the US elections this year are going to be in terms of shaping the world outlook of renewable energy and sustainable development?
I think, Yash, it's going to be very, very critical. And if I had to put in a preference on in the US election, not that I vote in the US, but if I had to vote in the US, this would, just this one issue would sway my vote. Because clearly, one party in the US, or at least one candidate for the elections, does not believe in climate science at all, right? And the other one does. And to my mind, we've already had a setback of 4 years, and we cannot afford another 4 years, because we just don't have time. As I said earlier, we have only 10 to 15 years in which to solve the problem. The world has to come together and act. And you can't do that if the largest economy in the world, which accounts for 20% of total economic output and 15% of the world's total carbon emissions, just says, I'm out of it, right? First thing is, of course, that whole 15% is not going to be controlled. And secondly, you need their leadership. You need them to be providing leadership to the rest of the world. You need them to be bashing heads together of people who are not showing up at the table. Now, if they're themselves not on the table and they say, ah, climate science, I don't believe in it. There is no global warming. It's all man-made. And it's not man-made, sorry. It's all natural. And I don't know whether you saw the last debate or not, the last presidential debate. But, you know, one of the candidates talked about windmills. And he said, windmills, these things kill birds. They just kill birds all the time. And they're noxious fumes that come out from the ground because of the windmills. Now, I don't know where, you know, people are getting the information from. But this is totally, totally, totally not true. And so therefore, you're absolutely right. The US elections are extremely critical. The outcome of the US elections is extremely critical to how the world deals with climate change in the future. And I cannot imagine that this issue is not getting more traction. And the thing that really bothers me the most is that almost 50% of the US doesn't care about this issue enough because they vote, right? Now, to me, this is just one issue that is critical enough for people to just say, okay, on this issue itself, everything is, should be decided. But it's really not a concern for a large part of the US population. So that's a worrying factor, actually, because too many people in the world are not taking climate change seriously enough as they should.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And for our last question for the day, Varsha.
Hi, I just wanted to ask, so automobile emissions are one of the contributing factors to global warming and air pollution. So is there any work being done in the fields of electric cars, solar powered cars or something similar to that?
No, you know that there is a lot of work being done. Obviously, Tesla is the best example of that. They took the lead earliest. But I'll give you an interesting data point now that you've asked me this question. You know, in the whole world, there is this transition happening of value from the fossil fuel companies to the clean energy companies of the future. And till about 10 years ago, the biggest company in the world was a company called ExxonMobil. Their market cap was about $450 billion or thereabouts, right? Now forget what's happened to the tech world because the tech world has totally gone to a different level. But ExxonMobil itself, their market cap, which was at one point the biggest in the world, has gone from $450 billion now down to about $140 billion. And the biggest renewable energy company now in the world, which is a US company called NextEra, now has a market cap that is more than ExxonMobil's market cap. And this change actually happened just very recently. And so that gives you a sense that the value is migrating from the traditional economy of based on fossil fuels to the new economy based on clean energy. Same thing applies to Tesla. If you look at Tesla's market cap, it's gone through the roof. I'm sure you must have seen that. It's gone to $450 billion, right? Which is where ExxonMobil used to be once upon a time. And the market capitalization of Tesla is equal to the next 9 car companies put together. Toyota, Daimler, BMW, Nissan, GM, Ford, Chrysler. I don't even know what are the companies. But that one company by itself, which is really an upstart company with new technology, electric vehicle technology, has suddenly gone through the roof, and all the other companies are struggling to play catch up. And so really, to answer your question about electric vehicles, yes, it's a revolution that is in the making right now. It's still at early stages. Part of the reason is that we need to have more capacity in manufacturing. I think people want to buy more electric cars, so the demand is there. But we also need that to come into India. I think we need more, we need the whole start of the electric car movement in India. I'm just waiting for a good electric car to come out so that I can buy it. I know that we still don't have charging stations everywhere, but I'm pretty sure that infrastructure will get set up as well. And then, at least the vehicular pollution that we have in cities like Delhi and Northern India and so on, at least that can start getting addressed. So it's very, very important for us that this whole electric vehicle revolution really, really moves fast and the government does whatever it can to incentivize it. And all of us as consumers, we in our respective families, make sure that we move to electric vehicles at the first available opportunity. And that's very critical.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sinha, for joining us today. Your talk and all your answers to the questions were very insightful And I'm sure that all of us learned a lot from it, especially because this issue is something that's so important.
Great. Thank you so much for inviting me, Isha. And thank you to DIIS. And thank you for all the students for listening.